Thank you, Dr. Kaustubh, for your wonderful lecture. And due to time constraint, we will be answering your queries in chat box. Now I will invite Dr. Galdar for his presentation. Dr. Galdar, sir, please.
Good morning, friends. I am Dr. Chandrakant Galdar. I am working as assistant professor and radiological safety officer at Mumbai Veterinary College. Today, we are delivering webinar on radiation, radioisotope, radiation hazards, and principles of radiation safety. First of all, I would like to thank our university authorities, Maharashtra Animal and Fishery Sciences University authorities. I am also thankful to our Dynamic Associate Dean, Dr. A.S. Ranade sir. I am thankful to ISVM family, especially Dr. D.S. Nauryal sir and Dr. R. Ramaprabhu sir for acting as a part for this particular webinar. I am also thankful to Dr. R.V. Gaikwad sir, Dr. P.R. Chaudhary sir as a part of this webinar. And I am also thankful to Dr. K.V. Garud. I should also appreciate the wonderful lecture given by Dr. Garud in first half. He has maximally concentrated upon the overview of radiation use in veterinary clinical practice. I am also thankful to the staff of Department of Veterinary Nuclear Medicine and staff of Veterinary Clinical Medicine who are the integral part of this particular webinar. So friends, today our topic is about the radiation and radioisotope and radiation protection. So when we people come across with such type of symbols, okay, this is the first symbol. When we come across with these symbols, this symbol and this symbol, okay, these are the symbol. When somebody is get in front of this particular symbol or come across with this particular symbol, okay, what is going to happen? We are getting some sort of the fearness. But please don't get fear, okay, please don't get fear, as these are the symbols having its unique importance, and there is nothing to get worry about these particular symbols. When we are going to see this symbol, first symbol, this symbol is of, just see, the first symbol is there, okay, this symbol is of radiation protection, okay. When such type of symbol is pasted anywhere, okay, this indicate that radiation work is going inside that particular premises, and this symbol indicate that only authorized persons, they are permitted to enter in that premises. However, second symbol is nothing but a symbol of X-ray, okay. In this particular symbol or symbol of X-ray, it can indicate that X-ray facility is available, and X-ray are the radioactive material, they are available inside, and people, they are doing the X-ray of their patient. So it means don't get frightened or panic when such type of symbols are pasted on some laboratory and when you are going to be nearby to that particular laboratory. So first symbol is symbol of radiation. This indicates that radioactive work is going on in that premises. At the same time, second symbol is nothing but the symbol of X-ray, where X-ray facility is available and patients, they are undergoing the X-ray examination. Now, as our topic is related to radiation, radioisotopes and radiation hazard and principles of radiation safety, so directly going to our topic of interest, I would like to discuss about some role of veterinarian. Okay, what is the role of veterinarian and how radiation safety is of integral part or important part as far as the veterinary services are concerned or veterinary duties are concerned. So we will check. Now, what is the role of veterinarian? We know the clinical department, especially surgery department is there, gynecology department is there, medicine department is there, in that clinical medicine, preventive medicine, okay, these departments are there. So maximumly we clinical departments were associated with prevention and eradication of the disease. At the same time, as far as the clinical departments are concerned, we are also associated with diagnosis and treatment of the disease. See, dear friends, when we are student, okay, when we are going to see the time 10 year or 15 year back, during that time, duties of veterinarian are prevention and eradication or treatment of the diseases. But now, as IT sector, it is going to be developed very rapidly. So, the demand from the public or pet parent or animal owner or farmers is also going to be increased. So, they are demanding. And what is their demand? Their first demand is that they should have early stage disease diagnosis. And when they come to know early stage disease diagnosis, they want to know the prognosis of the clinical cases or the patient or pet they have associated with this. And second, they are not going to be satisfied only with the thing of early disease diagnosis and its prognosis. They also want to know that what is the physiological or pathological changes associated with the system in their patient. So, earlier role was only prevention and control or treatment of the disease, but as time is going to be changed, we are getting change in the demand from the pet parent or animal owners. So, this clearly indicates that we should have high quality veterinary diagnostic services, and this is the only remedy where we can able to satisfy whatever the current demand of the public or animal owner or farmers is concerned. Okay. Now, this is the first step I am taking you people for radiation exposure. We will see veterinarians and how radiation exposure is going to happen. Just we will check this first. Then we will come across with the information about the radioisotope, radiation and different radiation protection assessment available in our veterinary clinical practice. So, veterinarians and radiation exposure, where do get the radiation exposure? We know we are the veterinarians, BVSC and AEH, VCI or whatever that means local body authorized person is there, he is entitled to do the practice. Okay. And as far as the recent rules of Atomic Energy Regulatory Boards are concerned, now they are also permitted BVS and AH and MUC qualification as a one qualification to work in the radiation area. Okay. So, being a veterinarian, where we are getting radiation exposure? First is diagnostic radiology, second is gamma scintigraphy, third is radioisotope laboratory where we are performing radioimmunoassay or radioimmunometric assays. For example, estimations of hormones are there, thyroid hormone is there, or n number of hormones, they are going to be, it means estimated by a technique called as RIA, radioimmunoassay. And last one, that is electron capture detector, ECD, they are commonly available now in the Department of Veterinary Public Health. At the same time, some specialized laboratory, for example, in Department of Biotechnology is there, again, Department of you may be able to say that biochemistry is there, okay? They are now using ECD as one part as far as the gas chromatography are concerned. So, we can see now, very well appreciate now, where we are getting radiation exposure. First is diagnostic radiology, second is gamma scintigraphy, third is RIA, and fourth is ECD. But in morning also, or just sometime before also, we have seen the lecture of Dr. Kostup. He has carried out one survey, okay, where he has pointed out that diagnostic radiology is the maximally practicing radiation, maximum veterinarians, they are practicing radiation in form of diagnostic radiology as far as their veterinary clinical practice is concerned. Means X-ray there comes in the picture, or diagnostic radiology is the first where we are getting maximum radiation exposure to our veterinarians. No doubt gamma scintigraphy is there, again RI is there, and electron capture detectors, ECD and other things are there. Okay, they are also B1 facilities where veterinarians can get the radiation exposure. Okay. Now we'll see how veterinarians they are getting radiation exposure as far as the diagnostic radiology is concerned. I'm taking here X-ray as one example. Here we can able to see. Okay. Here we can see here the doctor, or we can able to say that chief of that particular facility, he may get the radiation exposure. Second, the assisting staff, the animal handler, and the patient itself. Okay, this is the X-ray machine. okay, X-ray, they are going to be emitted, or we are getting X-ray from this machine. So who are the, it means we are getting exposure. To whom we are getting exposure here? First is the chief veterinary officer, second assisting veterinary officer, third animal handler, okay. Patient itself is the one source for the radiation exposure. So in diagnostic radiology, three human being or three person, chief veterinary officer, assisting veterinary officer and handler, they are the person to whom radiation exposures are there. At the same time, we may be able to show that patients are also there, they are getting the radiation exposure. We can see next slide. Okay, now here in gamma scintigraphy, okay, in gamma scintigraphy, this is the patient, okay, this is the patient, okay, patient is act as the one source of radiation exposure. Now here radiological safety officer is getting radiation exposure, the person who is doing, who is on console or acquiring the image, he is also getting radiation exposure, and then animal handlers are there, this animal handlers, they are also going to get a radiation exposure. We have earlier seen the first slide where we have seen the first slide we have seen here we have seen radiation exposure in diagnostic radiology to all where source of X-ray is there. At the same time, similar type of the radiation exposure also we can expect in gamma scintigraphy also. Here in the gamma scintigraphy, we are using 99m technetium as a radioactive material. In diagnostic radiology, we are using X-ray as the radioactive material. And now this is a radioimmunoassay, RIA, where the person who is doing the assay procedure as such, or who is involved in the qualitative or quantitative assessment of the hormones and other thing, or that procedure, okay, he is the veterinarian who is getting the exposure in radioimmunoassay. The radioactive material we are using in radioimmunoassay is nothing but iodine-125. You can see next. Now there are certain laboratory, for example, in veterinary public health for finding out the drug residues and other thing. At the same time, in some biochemistry laboratory, we are getting this instrument. It is ECD. Okay, in this instrument or this chromatography instrument, ECD is there, where nickel 63 is the radioactive metal going to be used as a source for to undertake that procedure. Okay, and this could be act as the one source for radiation exposure. So dear friends, what were the earlier slides are there? In the earlier slides, we have seen about the radiation, how what is the role of veterinarian and how veterinarians, they are going to be exposed to the radiation. Okay, now I am going to be brief and concise about, let me just, what is radiation, or concise about the radiation. So what is atomic structure, atomic mass and other thing, that we will discuss in 4 to 5 slides. We can see here. Okay, what is atomic structure? We can see. Okay, atomic structure is nothing but a simple thing. Atom. Okay, in the atom, at the center, we are getting proton. Okay, at the center, we are getting proton. Here at the center, we are getting proton and neutron. Okay, and electrons, they are revolving around the nucleus. Okay, they are revolving around the nucleus. Means nucleus is a part where protons and neutrons are there. At the same time, electrons, they are present in orbital manner around the, whatever that means, nucleus is there. So nucleus consists of two type of atomic particles, in that proton and neutron. Okay, they are nothing but the nucleons. At the same time, electrons, they are revolving around the nucleus. Okay, these are the electrons, we can very well see. Okay, these are the electrons, they are rotating, or in orbital manner, they are moving around the nucleus. Now we will see. We have seen the nucleons. Okay, in the nucleons are there. In the nucleons, what we have seen? In the nucleons, we have seen three. It means two important component. One is the proton, and second is the neutron. Okay. Now, in the details of atom, what are the points available there? One is proton, second is neutron, and third is electron. The charge going to be carried by the proton is plus one positive charge. At the same time, its mass is 1.67 into 10 raised to power minus 27 kg. Okay. Neutron, it's neutral. It won't carry any charge. Okay. At the same time, electron is there. That electron is going to be carry minus one charge, and its mass is less mass than the proton and neutron. Okay, and its mass is 9.11 into 10 raised to power minus 30. Okay, when we are comparing the masses of proton, neutron, and electron, proton and neutron, they are almost same mass, but a proton is almost 2000 times more massive than the electron. Okay, means electron is very lighter as compared to nucleons or as compared to protons and neutrons. So we can get very well idea that electrons, they are very light as far as the weights are concerned, and they are revolving outside the nucleus with the minor mass. Okay, and they are carrying negative charge. So this is the basic about the radioactive material or atomic structure we should have idea before initiating the discussion about the what is meant by radiation. Now we can see basic isotope notation, how isotopes they are going to be noted out. Okay, basic isotope notation. Okay, here basic isotope notation is there. Here X is the one atom. Okay, X is the one atom, this X, where A is atomic mass number, mass of that particular atom. Z is atomic number, which is nothing but number of protons or electrons, and N is nothing but number of neutrons. So basically, just understand, when we are going to see any atom, okay, it is going to be designated or described by its atomic mass number and atomic number. So what is there in atomic mass number? It is A, and it is nothing but Z plus N. What is Z plus N? It is nothing but we are getting atomic number, okay, plus number of neutrons. Z is nothing but atomic number, where the it is nothing but protons or electrons available with that particular atom, and N is nothing but the number of neutrons. So this is the basic isotope notation we are undertaking when we are going to study any atom. We can see now an example of iodine. Here iodine basic notation, we can see 131 is nothing but atomic mass number, 53 is atomic number. Okay, and now when iodine isotope or basic notation of any isotope we are dealing during that time, we should have idea about differences in between isotopes and isobar. It is very simple to differentiate in between the isotopes and isobar. Isotopes, they are nothing but same atomic number but have different mass number. Okay, they are having same atomic number, means they are atom of same element, so their chemical properties, they are similar. But when we are going to see the isobar, they are having same mass number, means mass number is same but they are different as far as their atomic numbers, so that their chemical properties, they are totally different as compared to the isotopes. So basic representation of any atom, we have to know about the atomic number, atomic mass number. At the same time, we should say what is isotope and isobar. Okay, now this is the thrust area and basic part of our today's webinar. Okay, simple nuclear stability and decay. Okay, once you understand this particular slide in proper way, you may be able to understand what is meant by radioactivity. Okay, As a radiological safety officer, we used to conduct some radiation, it means safety program, that departmental direction course module for the students who are working with us as far as the nuclear medicine facility is concerned or radioisotope facility is concerned. During that time, we are conducting one direction course module. So I used to ask that student, okay, so what is my stability, okay? So they are telling, sir, after completion of or graduation or post graduation, when we are getting good job in state government, for example, veterinary assistant surgeon is there or livestock development officer is there, it means we are going to be stable. This indicates that when people there or student, they are in student life, they are working hard for good research work or good percentage. Why? Because they want to get stable. And what is there? In stage of stability, they want to be a good government job or a good job so that they can, it means whatever their life is there, they can, it means, keep their life in an easy manner and other thing. Similar concept is also available. Same concept is also available as far as the nuclear stability is concerned. Okay, we have seen the basic structure of atom. In the atom, what are the nucleons are there? Nucleons, they are nothing but protons and neutrons. The charge going to be carried by the proton is nothing but positive charge, and neutron, they are neutral in nature. Means in nucleus, if equal number of proton and neutrons are there, okay, they won't get any, it means fighting and other thing. They are very happy because they are equal in number. So we are telling that particular isotope or that particular atom is stable. Okay, these are the laughing faces. Okay, this clearly indicate that now in, just wait. Okay, this is the slide where laughing faces are there. This clearly indicate, okay, we have equal number of protons and neutrons and we are very, very happy because we are stable. Okay, I think this is the self-explanatory. We will see what is going to happen as far as the nuclear instability is concerned. Just a bit. Okay, nuclear instability. I have just explained that nuclear stability, equal number of proton and neutron. But when in the nucleus, we are getting odd number of proton and neutron, their concept is that we may be able to get neutron rich or neutron deficient, or proton rich, proton deficient, vice versa. Okay, that isotopes, they are called as the unstable isotopes. Okay, and they want to get stable. Okay, and they want to get stable. It means these particular isotopes, they are in the student life. They are doing hard work for their thesis work. They are doing hard work for good studies and getting maximum percentage so that they may get stable in proper way. Similarly, the same concept is also applicable here, where odd number of protons and neutrons, okay, they are there and nucleus want to stable. Okay, this instability, why this instability is there? Instability is available here. Why? Because odd number of protons and neutrons are there. Okay, means I want to get stable, or isotope want to be stable, means either he should remove neutron or he should remove proton. So what are the concept available? In nutshell, we will see that concept also. In earlier side, just I told that neutron rich and neutron deficient, if that inequality is there, this may leads into nuclear instability. So what is going to happen when there is neutron rich component is there, or atom is there, neutron rich component or atom is there, okay? What are you going to do? Here, neutron is converted into proton. Neutron kya bolega, or what will neutron tell? Oh, I am rich, okay, but I want to stable. So how I can get stable? I can convert into proton, okay? And some radioactive emission is going to be happen here, especially beta minus emission is going to be happen. Similarly, if neutron deficient components are there or atoms are there, okay, means neutron deficient, what does it indicate? It indicate that proton rich. When the proton rich is there, see, neutron carrying no charge, proton carry plus one charge or positive charge, then proton thought to be converted into neutron, and when it is going to be converted into neutron, we are getting positron emission or beta plus emission is there. Okay, and as far as the change in Z number is concerned or atomic number is concerned, when neutron rich metals are there or atoms are there, we are getting increase in the value of Z by 1. At the same time, when we are getting the neutron deficient applicability of the concept, where Z number or atomic number is going to be decreased by 1. So this is the basic concept. So this is the basic concept where we can understand if any atom is neutron rich, so it will convert into proton and emission of the radioactivity is there or energy is there in the form of beta minus decay. At the same time, when proton reaches there, then there is change and we are getting emission of the radioactive metal or radioactivity in the form of B plus. It is nothing but the positron emission. Just for understanding, I am telling that we should have idea why radiation they are going to be emerge. Okay, radiation they are going to be emerge only from that nuclei. They are unstable in nature. If nuclei they are stable, they will not emit any energy as far as the stability is concerned. But once unstable nuclei are there, they want to get the stable. And how they are going to be stable? They are going to be stable by emitting some sort of the energy, and that energy is nothing but the radiation. Okay, now we can see, I think I have covered about the role of veterinarian. After that, how veterinarians they are getting radiation exposure. After that, I have covered about the concise about the, it means atomic structure and other thing. Now we'll see functional differences as far as the diagnostic mortalities are concerned. Okay, because as far as the role of veterinarian and routes of getting radiation exposure to the veterinarian, I told that diagnostic radiology comes number one, where maximum veterinarians they are working and they are getting the chances of radiation exposure. Similarly, gamma scintigraphy also nowadays, it means good, it means practice people they are adopting, which will give us idea about the good diagnostic information where radiation exposure chances are there for the practicing veterinarians. So we'll see what are the functional differences in diagnostic mortalities, because this understanding is most important. On the basis of that, radiation protection principle can be implemented. Now we'll see. First image is there. This image is of X-ray. So what is going to happen? And second image is there. It is of nuclear medicine. In the X-ray they are going to be generated in the X-ray tube, and X-ray they are thrown, okay, on the human body or animal body, and images they are going to be captured. But in nuclear medicine, we are injecting radioactive material inside the body of animal or human being, and that radioactive material is going to be emitted out, and that radioactive material we are, or that radiation or that radioactive rays that we are, it means capturing by the that radioactive material sensitive cameras. For example, we can see here, able to explain you in proper way. This is X-ray, okay, this X-ray tube is there. X-rays, they are now X-ray, they are just shoot, we have shoot the X-ray, they are going to be passed here, okay, and now on this cassette we are recording the things. Means X-ray they are going to be passing and we are recording that, it means picture here on the cassette. But what is going to happen as far as nuclear medicine is concerned? Here in nuclear medicine, we are injecting radioactive material inside the body of animal or human being, and this radiation they are going to be propagated and they are taken up by the camera. Here gamma irradiated material we are injecting, and gamma camera are the device where we can able to, it means detect and capture the image and do its qualitative and quantitative analysis. Again, in depth or again in detail, I can show you. I think one slide is with me. Yeah, we can see here. Okay, functional differences in diagnostic modality. We are seeing here X-ray tube. Okay, here we can see X-ray tube and X-ray they are going to pass here, and image is going to be generated. Okay, so here in X-ray we are getting information about the structural abnormality of the organ. But here we can see, you can very well appreciate this particular patient, okay, to whom we have injected the radioactive material. Now this patient is going to be act as the material for gamma irradiation is there, and this is the gamma camera where we are taking the image, and this is the console where we are analyzing, capturing and analyzing the image. So diagnostic modality difference, as per the diagnostic radiology is concerned, maximally we are getting the idea about the functional abnormality, In diagnostic radiology, we are getting idea about the structural abnormality, not functional abnormality. At the same time, as far as the gamma scintigraphy is concerned, we are getting idea about functional abnormality or physiological differences in that particular organ. Okay? Yeah. This slide is the self-explanatory. Okay? Here in X-ray, okay, we are getting idea. Now, first slide is of X-ray or first photograph is of X-ray, where we can able to say that we are getting hepatomegaly. Okay? So, structural abnormality, when I am going to see the X-ray, I can get, oh, hepatomegaly is there. But I could not able to get idea what is the functional abnormality, what is the abnormality available as far as the hepatocyte function is there or the cells of immune system available in the liver. But by help of the gamma scintigraphy, we can able to say, okay, this is the anterior or lateral images. Okay, here, in here, we cannot able to take 360 angle image. Okay, no doubt, as per the diagnostic radiology is concerned, in cases of CT, we may able to give 360 angle image, where structural abnormality or if any space occupying lesion is there, what is that means? Integrity of that particular space occupying lesion, we may able to measure. But here, as far as the gamma scintigraphy is concerned, we are getting idea about the functional abnormality as far as the organs are concerned. Okay, so basic difference in diagnostic radiology, we are getting idea or diagnostic information idea. It is nothing but structural abnormality. Where in gamma scintigraphy, we are getting idea about the functional abnormality as far as the organs are concerned or systems are concerned. Next, now some common radiation terms. Okay, as now I am opening chapter from role of veterinarian, then exposure to the veterinarian, then basic atomic structure, okay, that we have seen. Now, how radiation is there and what are the common radiation terms they are using. Now, we are just opening one page by page about the information about the radiation, radioisotope and its hazardous effect. So, first, common radiation terms. What are the common radiation terms? First term is the radioactivity. How radioactivity is going to be generated? I told whatever the unstable nuclei there or atom are there, they want to get stable. And how they are going to be stable? By emitting the energy, and that energy is nothing but radioactive material. Okay? So, term radioactivity, its meaning is that amount of radiation being given off or emitted by a radioactive material. Okay? And its unit is becquerel. CI is the Curie unit. Okay? And now, what are the internationally accepted unit is the becquerel. Second is radiation dose. Okay? Radiation dose is nothing but radiation dose absorbed by a person when any radioactive material is going to be, it may shoot on the or thrown or get exposed. Okay? Or it is nothing but the amount of energy is deposited in human tissue or animal tissue by a radiation. And third is, and its unit is nothing but rad, it is nothing but radiation absorbed dose, or in SI unit it is nothing but the gray. And third important term we are commonly using in radiation or radiation protection, it is nothing but biological dose. And veterinarians, we are much more should know maximum about the biological dose. In that, the biological risk, it is nothing but the biological risk of the exposure in that is going to be caused because of the radiation, and it is going to be expressed by the unit REM, or now SI unit is nothing but CWAT, SV, CWAT is the unit we are going to be utilized. Now, as seen these terms and its meaning, I would like to explain it in pictorial form. Now, we can see it here very well. Okay. Now, this is the radioactive material. Okay. And this radiation is going to be emitted. This radiation we can able to measure as far as the unit, it is called as the becquerel. Okay. And when this radiation, okay, this is the radiation exposure, okay, when this radiation depositing some sort of the energy, okay, that is going to be, it means presented by a unit called rad or gray. And biological dose, this point is most important because TLD maximally we are applying here on chest area, okay, so it indicates the nature, or it means it is a risk assessment or risk dose. So, biological dose that can be associated, and it is going to be demarcated by a unit called as the REM or CWAT. So now we can get very well idea. First is the part radiation, it should be measured and its unit is curie or becquerel. Second, radiation is depositing some energy, because I told radiation is nothing but the energy. This radiation is depositing some energy. Okay, that deposition energy is nothing but rad or gray. And when that dosing is going to happen to the human being or practicing veterinarian, okay, and it means associated with the risk. Okay, it is going to be measured by the unit called as a rem or sievert. Okay, the next, now this is the thrust area, and this part I would like to, it means, discuss very intensively and deeply with all my practicing veterinarians who are associated with the radiation work. So radiation hazard is most important, and this background will definitely help you to undertake what is meant by radiation and what are the radiation hazards. So before getting to radiation or radiation hazard, we will see what is meant by radiation again. Okay, radiation is nothing but a radioactive atom. It is going to emit the energy. Okay, and that energy, why it is going to be emitted energy, we have discussed that to get stability, unstable nuclei want to get stable. And how that unstable nuclei is going to be stable? By emitting energy, and that energy is nothing but radiation. Simple dhyan mein rakhiye, ek simplest said, radiation is nothing, dynamic term and other thing. Radiation is nothing but energy. Radiation dusra kuch nahi hai, ek energy hai, theek hai. Aur ye energy kahan se aa rahi hai? Whatever the unstable nuclei is there, they want to get stable by emitting some sort of the energy, and that energy is dissipated in the form of radiation. Now this is the self-explanatory slide. Okay, if practicing veterinarian, if he is going to be understand this slide, okay, he can understand everything as far as the radiation hazards are concerned. Okay, this simple self-explanatory slide, I will take a couple of minutes to explain it in deep way. Okay, now this is the radiation. Okay, and this radiation is hit to the water molecule, because our body is consist of about more than 60 to 70% of the water. We'll take ideal example of water. When this energy, radiation deposit energy in the water molecule, okay, what is going to happen? We are getting genesis of equation 1. What is first equation? H2O, when water molecule absorb that energy. Okay, during that time, that energy may hit any electron or H2O. It can be represented as HHO or HOH or OHH. Okay, when this energy is deposited by the radioactive material, we are getting equation first. It is nothing but the water ion, okay, and free electron. Okay, second, this particular positive water ion is there in second equation. What is going to happen in this pod? This is highly reactive. Okay, these are the free radicals, they are very highly reactive. This will dissipate into H plus and OH minus. Okay, this OH, I have represented it by a star. Okay, this is nothing but hydroxyl free radical. Means now we are taking basic constituent as water, and how radiation hits the water and how free radicals they are going to be formed. You know, once free radicals they are going to be formed, they are highly reactive because they are having unequal configuration as far as the electrons are concerned. Though so, they are very reactive and they want to react with each other. So third, from first equation, reaction with other water molecule, this is the one water molecule, it is going to be damaged. Now what is the reaction with other water molecule? Same H2O, E electron we are getting, and H2O minus. So ultimately, exposure of radiation to water molecule leads into, or irradiation of water leads into, formation of free radicals. Okay, OH I have represent it by the star, and H star I have represented. Okay, these are the free radicals, and now this particular water is highly reactive. These free radicals, now they are formed and they can able to damage the system. Okay, so basically we should understand water we have taken as an example, where radiation depositing this energy to the water in such a way that one electron from water molecule is going to be emitted out, and we are getting positive water ion formation. At the same time, second positive water formation will leads into, in second equation we can see hydroxyl free radical. Similarly, hydrogen free radical is also going to form. So what is end result of radiation? Radiation, it hit the water molecule and we are getting formation of free radicals. Okay, here H2O2 is there, just I can, here H2O2 is there, or we are getting H2O2 is there, or HO2 is there. Okay, they are very reactive, and they are reactive as far as the lipids are concerned. So we know that nucleus is there, or whatever the cell wall and other thing is there, they are rich in lipidal structure, and this reactive molecule, they can damage the whatever, that means lipidal or cellular structures are there. Now we can able to get the correlation now, how water is going to be damaged, how free radicals they are going to be developed, and how these free radicals they are doing their impact as far as the sensitive lipid membrane is concerned. So in nutshell, cellular radiation and cellular water, that type of things we can very well understand now. Now we can see what is the direct damage of the radiation. Dear friends, there are two important damage of the radiation. First is the radiation and direct damage, and second, radiation and indirect damage. At the same time, we can also see what are the deterministic effect and what are the stochastic effect as far as the radiation and it means its harmful effects are concerned. So first, as far as the direct damage is concerned, radioactive material, they are directly damaged to the cellular level, at the chromosomal level and other thing, where deletion, inversion, translocation and reciprocal translocation, these are the things, okay, they are going to be happen, or these are the entities they are generated because of the radiation. And once we are getting DNA damage, and if that repair DNA, damaged DNA is not going to be repaired in proper way, subsequently complications they are going to be happen there. Okay, this is about the direct damage. Second, radiation and indirect damage. This example we have seen. Now, water molecule, this is reactive water molecule, or free radicals are there. Okay, this X-ray photon emitted on the dissipate energy to the water molecule. This water molecule is nothing but the water molecule available in the cellular level. So free radicals, they are going to be formed. They are very reactive, okay, as far as the cellular structures are concerned, and they causes the indirect damage, okay, as far as the our DNAs are concerned. This is the example of direct damage, where we can very well appreciate directly DNA. But here DNA, they are going to be affected, but how? Indirectly, where reactive water molecule or free radicals, they are responsible to cause the abnormality, or they are responsible to cause the radiation hazards. Now we can see deterministic and stochastic effect. Okay, the deterministic effect is nothing but this effect only occur once a threshold of exposure have been exceeded. Dear friend, just remember our discussion before 5 to 10 minutes, where I have told you about the different radiation terms. When we come across with the information of one biological dose, okay? So deterministic effect is that we are getting some biological effect, and after that some symptoms or radiation damage can be existed. But stochastic defect, they are by chance, okay? And in stochastic effect, what is going to happen? Stochastic effect occur randomly to the public of randomly, the probability of which increase with the risk, increase the dose with the threshold, okay? Deterministic effect, what are the example of determination? Cataract is there, skin erythema is there, sterility is there. Okay, these are the example of deterministic effect. And what are the example of stochastic effect? Example of stochastic effect are, cancer is there, then hereditary effect is there. Okay, but deterministic effect, they are dose dependent, whereas stochastic, it means effects are there where dosing and other thing is not. Okay, here it means randomly they can going to be happen, or they can going to be generate. Now, this part is most important, and all of my friends who are practicing the radiation, they should have idea about the principles of radiation protection. Okay, so we will see in detail about the principles of radiation protection. So what is that? Now dear friends, this is the most important slide. Okay, what is going to happen here? Principles of radiation protection I have explained in 3 points. First is justification, okay. Second is optimization, and third is dose limit. Justification is most important as far as our veterinary clinical practice is concerned and use of radiation is concerned. Justification is nothing but I should ask one question to me, if I am a diagnostic radiologist or if I am nuclear medicine clinician or physician, I should ask first question to me. I should, that means ask, if I am going to use this diagnostic modality in this particular animal, okay, what type of information I am getting, okay, and if this information is really beneficial to my patient, then and then only I can do this nuclear medicine or this radiation procedure. We can take an example. For example, a clinical case of fracture is there, and in palpation only I come to know complete fracture is there, and in that cases I am doing the diagnostic radiology. So it is not, it means promising, no, only, or it is not justifiable. If some minor hairline fracture is there, but pain is there, but in palpation we are unable to diagnose the things, so we can undertake the diagnostic radiology. Justification is nothing but we have to ask whether the procedure which I am adopting or recommending is giving beneficial as far as the diagnostic information is concerned with the patient or not. Okay, second is optimization. I have decided now I should do diagnostic radiology for this particular patient. Okay, now matter of justification is finished. Okay, we have now convinced that if I am using a diagnostic radiology procedure, okay, it is going to be give us me idea about the proper diagnostic, or whatever the information I am getting is really helpful for me for further investigation or for planning of the my further therapeutic management protocol. Now I should do the optimization of the radiation procedure. In the optimization of radiation procedure, the principle which we should always follow is nothing but ALARA. Okay, ALARA. This principle is most important, and please keep this words always with you when you are practicing the radiation. Okay, it is nothing but ALARA. ALARA. What is, how I am pronouncing it? It is nothing but ALARA. Okay, it is nothing but, again I am repeating, ALARA. What does it mean? As low as reasonably achievable. Okay, ALARA, ALARA, as low as reasonably achievable. Okay, and third most important principle we can follow, it is nothing but dose limit. Dose limit means not our medicine dose and other thing. Okay, this 1 milligram per kg body weight, 5 milligram per kg body weight, that type of radiation dose. Okay, that dose limit, and it should not exceed, never exceed. Okay, for ourselves also, for a practicing veterinarian in radiation also, and for the public also. Okay, radiation exposure is important. Okay, and we should follow strict guideline that radiation exposure, there are guidelines that radiation exposure for a practicing radioactive worker is different, radiation exposure for the public is totally different. Okay, this limit should not be exceeded. Ye dhyan mein rakhna hai. Please keep this in mind. Okay, so what are the principles here? We can just take a brief recall. Here justification is most important. Justification means we should convince diagnostic information which one is going to be yield there of some value. Once I have decided, justified, then I am undertaking the procedure. In that I should do the optimization. It is nothing but as low as reasonably achievable, that I will explain next slide. And third, I should consider, or I should concentrate on the dose limit, which should not be exceed as per the prescribed limit given by the ARB, Atomic Energy Regulatory Board, for practicing veterinarians who are working in the, or who are working in radiation at the same time for the public also. Okay, now radiation protection and safety in veterinary practice. Okay, am again repeating this word, okay? Alara, A-L-A-R-A, okay? Alara is nothing but as low as reasonably achievable. And how I can do this practice? Okay, there are time, distance, shielding and activity. These are the basic compounds, okay? We should just concentrate on this, okay? These are the constituents of the Alara. What are the constituents? Name of that constituents? One is the time, second is the distance, third is shielding and fourth is activity, okay? Now, we can see one by one. We can see one by one time. See, radiation exposure is directly proportional to time. Okay, if you are going to be in a radiation facility for longer time, the exposure you are getting as per the radiations are concerned will be more. Distance, you have to keep maximum distance from the source of radiation. Okay, the exposure is inversely proportional to square of distance. Okay, I is inversely or directly proportional to 1 divided by d square. This is the formula generally we nuclear medicine people they are using. We are using. So I is the term I am using for the radioactive exposure. So I is directly proportional to time. Means radiation exposure will be high if you are going to spend maximum time. Okay. Second, I is proportional to 1 divided by d square. Means if I am going to be increase the distance by 2-fold or 3-fold in that capacity, the as I am going to be increase the distance, radiation exposure is going to be minimized. Third is shielding. Generally in X-ray or even though in nuclear medicine practice, we are using lead as a one compound as the shielding. Generally, shielding is recommended. The material whose or atomic material whose Z number is very high, okay, that material generally we are using for the shielding. And third is the activity. Fourth is the activity. Generally, if high activity source is there, we should not work in that high activity source. But 3 points we should understand. Okay, first, radiation protection optimization. How I can do? Okay, I can do by implementing the Alara. Okay, and how I can? What are the active constituents in the Alara? 3 constituents: time, distance, and shielding. I can remember this as a TDS. Okay, tax deducted at source. It is nothing but TDS here in nuclear medicine practice: time, distance, and shielding. Okay, for your easy understanding, I am telling. Okay, next. Now dose limits are there. I think Dr. Kaustubh he has finished up or come up with good information as far as the dose limitations are there. But being a practicing radiologist or a radiation worker, I am requesting that we should concentrate on whole body dose and at the same time dosing for the pregnant worker. But especially whole body dose, generally it should, whatever that means, occupational workers are there, for example, radiological safety officers like me or practicing veterinarians in radiation facility, the dose occupational exposure 20 millisieverts per year averaged over 5 consecutive years and 30 millisieverts in any single year. Okay, these are the ARB recommended. And for public, how much it is? It is 1 millisievert per year. So when we are occupational worker, as far as the radiation system is concerned or facility is concerned, our is 20 millisievert, but for public 1 millisievert. So we can very well appreciate why radiation safety is important. Okay, being a radiological safety officer or being a radiation person, we should keep one thing in our mind: whatever the radiation exposure we are getting, such type of high radiation exposure should not be diverted or given to the public. So being a veterinarian, we should keep one thing in our mind: occupational radiation exposure is different and public radiation exposure is different. Our duty is that public should not get the radiation exposure as like our occupational exposure. Now, radiation safety, some tips for X-ray facility, okay? Or I cannot say these are the tips and other thing. Generally, these are the guidelines or recommendations we can able to see. When we are working in diagnostic radiology, okay, we should follow 3 important, it means practices or etiquettes, I am able to say. First, what the personnel, for example, doctor or operating person should know. Okay, it means qualified person who having the TLD batches and other thing, what they should know. Second, we think that we should think what public should know. Okay, and third, what the owner or employer or radiation safety officer need to know. So forget about this. What being a doctor when we are working in the radiation facility? Okay, we should have protective barrier in our facility. We should have protective apron in our facility. At the same time, we should have TLD batches. Okay, this TLD batches is nothing but thermoluminescent dosimetry. This TLD batches will give us idea about the radiation exposure. The logic behind this analysis of the TLD batches are there. TLD batches we are applying on our chest. Whatever the radiation is there, that energy is deposited on the TLD batches. Electron, they will take the energy and jump from higher electronic state. Okay, and when this TLD batches we are giving to laboratory, they are hitting that one. And when that high energy component electrons are there, they are going to be losing the energy. And on that basis, we may be able to say what is the radiation exposure to that particular person. So being a radiation professional or doctor, when we are practicing diagnostic radiology, we should have protective barrier. We should use protective barrier in proper way. We should have lead apron. At the same time, we should have a TLD batches. Okay. Now, I'm giving some 1 or 2 minutes for personal monitoring as per the TLD are concerned. These are the two figures. Okay, wearing of the TLD batches is most important. TLD batch inside the lead apron at the chest level. Okay, we should always wear TLD batch below the apron. Okay, not above the apron, because if I'm going to use the TLD batch above the apron, it will not give me correct idea about the exposure of radiation, because I have already used radiation protection instrument, okay, lead apron, and after that I am getting radiation exposure. Means lead shielding is there, okay, that lead shielding is minimizing my radiation exposure, and that minimized radiation exposure should be noted by the TLD batch. So good practice is that we have to use TLD batches below the lead apron, okay, not above the TLD apron. Not above the lead apron. Okay, again, if needed, additional wrist batch we may be able to use. At the same time, if these two points are most important. Again, what are they? These points, I can tell you. Where is the slide? Just a minute. Okay, so storage of TLD batches is most important. As a radiological safety officer, I recommend that we should store radiological, it means this TLD batches, away from our radiation facility. At the same time, control cards should be kept away from the radiation area. And when we are working during only, we have to use the whatever the TLD batches are there. As we have finished up our work, just remove that TLD batch and keep where we have kept the control. So it will helpful for analyzing what is the actual exposure the radiation worker is getting because of the radiation. Now, protective barrier, I told that it is a good practice whenever we are shooting the x-ray or whenever we are doing the x-ray, we should use this protective barrier, or this is the window where we can see. Okay, so use of the protective barrier is most important. Now, practical difficulty I used to get, or query I used to get from practicing veterinarian, that they are telling about what to do about the uncooperative patient. Okay, in diagnostic x-ray, sometimes people are telling we can use anesthesia and other thing. Okay, but as far as the radiation safety point of view is concerned, I can able to suggest that whatever the lead apron is there, okay, you should give this lead apron to the pet parent who is handling the that particular patient. Okay, so that pet parent will get minimized radiation dose, and we should shoot the x-ray from the whatever the protective barriers are there. Okay, next, now some working guidelines for unsealed radioactivity. Unsealed radioactivity means this gallium 67 is there, or 99 technetium is there. These are the 10 general guidelines we are following in our Department of Nuclear Medicine, where full sleeve apron, which one is it means common for sealed and unsealed. At the same time, where appropriate protective clothing is there. At the same time, if you are having it means doubt that radiation exposure is there, during that time immediately called your radiological safety officer so that he can initiate whatever the needful inquiries or needful investigations are there. Okay, so these are the 10 points generally we are recommending or we are practicing in our Department of Veterinary Nuclear Medicine. Next, now at the last, I would like to conclude. Dear friend, Department of Nuclear Medicine is started in year 2003 here in Mumbai. Since that its establishment, me and my professor Dr. R.V. Gayakwad sir, we are associated with this facility, and almost we have completed more than 15 years, and we are really finding that no doubt radioisotopes have potential in veterinary practice for early disease diagnosis and therapeutic management and research. Okay, maximumly we are concentrated till that on the different disease diagnosis or early disease diagnosis or diagnosis of functional abnormality. At the same time, now radioisotope laboratory is in full swing, where we are doing the estimation of hormones of all domestic animal. So in conclusion, I would like to conclude, radioisotopes have potential in veterinary practice for early disease diagnosis, therapeutic management and research. Again, awareness about radiation exposure and radiation safety among veterinary professional would be obligating to minimize the adverse effect. So it is necessary to avoid the or minimize the adverse effect. Awareness about the radiation exposure and radiation safety is most important. Okay, so these are the two important points I would like to conclude. Now, as far as my department is concerned, we offer gamma scintigraphy services, RIN. Now, radioimmunoassay and immunoradiometric assay, they are in full swing, where we are giving services to veterinary clinical cases, veterinary research, biomedical research, novel drug development, and RIN IRM of the biological sample. Now, this is our team. This is our team. Dr. R.V. Gayakwad, he is in charge. Myself as a radiological safety officer. Dr. P.R. Choudhury, he is also visiting fellow with us. He is scientific officer at TRAC. Dr. P.S. Masare and Dr. K.V. Garud, both are scientists involved with us as far as the our radiation facilities are concerned. Okay. Again, if anyone is interested to make some collaboration as far as the radioimmunoassay facility is there or our nuclear medicine facility is there, okay, for collaborative work, we may able to contact to our professor Dr. R.V. Gayakwad sir or to me also. We are very free, it means interested to make a collaboration, especially in nuclear medicine and radioisotope laboratory for estimation of the hormones and other things. We have currently some research project on this aspect also. And as far as current lecture is concerned in this webinar, for any question, please contact. These are my email address and WhatsApp and mobile number. As I get your difficulty or any query as far as the present lecture is concerned, I will try to answer it on either WhatsApp or on my mobile. Okay, by mobile or by email also. So please communicate your questions or any difficulties to understand this radiation protection on my registered email address or my WhatsApp. Or we can also communicate the things to our ISVM Facebook portal is there, or that Facebook page is there. With this, I am thankful to all of you for active participation in this webinar. I am also thankful to our university authorities, my college authorities, the official bearers, executive committee members of Indian Society for Veterinary Medicine. I am also thankful to all of my colleagues who have supported me and promoted me so that I can conduct this webinar on radiation protection and deliver this information on radiation, radioisotope, radiation hazard and principles.